Hello everyone, my name's Liz Van Vliet. Welcome to my session as part of the June Virtual Summit. Today, I'm going to be talking to you about understanding and getting a handle on the informal power structure that operates within every organisation. It doesn't matter whether you're working for a large, medium-sized or small organisation, there is going to be what is commonly referred to as an informal shadow structure that is operating. It's a fact of life in any organisation, and it's very important as executive assistants that you have an awareness and an understanding of that structure and how it's actually operating at any given time within your organisation. As you know, I'm a big fan of really having a good level of awareness and a level of curiosity about the organisational politics that are going on around you. I don't believe that you are doing yourself any favours by burying your head in the sand and operating as though none of this is happening. I think you will be much better off if you have a level of awareness and understanding of the organisational politics as they're operating in your organisation. So today, I'm going to spend some time talking to you about why I believe that's important and why I believe that understanding organisational politics makes you a more astute executive assistant. I'm also going to talk about it in terms of the fact that studies show that people that have political skills do better. They manage stress better. They show up differently in their organisation and they have greater impact. And I think those three reasons alone are a good reason for, well, actually three good reasons why I think it's really important that you take on board what I'm going to share with you today. So let's talk about the fact that in any organisation, we have, as I said, the formal and the informal power structure, organisational structure that's going on. And as you can see from my little chart here, everybody who works in corporate life or in any organisation will have seen at some time or another an organisation chart. And actually what I've drawn up here, is actually just a snapshot of an org chart. You know, if I was to draw up a traditional org chart, you would see that it is, you know, a tree structure with the CEO at the top of the tree. And that is actually, it's important for me to make it clear that it's probably beyond the scope of anyone to, unless you're Machiavelli, to, who, if you don't know who that is, look it up, great Renaissance Italian political animal. But it's not realistic for me to expect you to have an understanding of the informal power structure that's operating within a broad organisation. So for the purposes of today and for the purposes of the way I want you to take this concept on board, I want you to think of this as something that you're going to do in as a mini experiment. You're going to take five people for our exercise today, and that's not very many. And as you can see from my diagram, and I'll go through that in a minute, they can be people that are on multiple levels within part of an organisation. And it obviously makes sense that you might want to start with people that you're directly affected by in terms of who you're supporting and who you need to influence as the executive assistant in an organisation. So let's talk again about the why. It's part of the concept, which Adam Fidler was the one who shared this metaphor with me, and I've held on to it ever since. So apologies, Adam, but I've totally stolen it. But Adam describes how strategic executive assistants make it make it something that they consider a part of their role to get up off the dance floor onto the balcony. And I love that analogy because, you know, when you're on the dance floor fighting for space and you're having people potentially, you know, pouring their drinks on you or hitting you with their elbows, it's very hard to be able to see the big picture. And what Adam's suggesting, and what I love about this analogy, is that strategic executive assistants take the time when they can and take time out of, you know, really out of their day to get up off the dance floor, get out of the everyday tasks and, you know, imminent deliverables that you're working on, and get up onto the balcony so that you have a really strategic view and are able to see the wood for the trees. And I'll come back to that because I'm mixing my metaphors, but it'll all make sense. My way of thinking about it, and I might draw this for you, is that when I talk about executive assistants, I like to talk about you having there being three axes, or, you know, and by axes, I'm talking about this sort of concept. We've got our X and our Y. And if we think about the vertical one being the functional, I call it the functional competencies. And this bottom one being what I've just talked about, the strategic capabilities or competencies. As executive assistants, you are going to find that there are those that either yourself or other executive assistants that you know, that you're going to be able to plot somewhere in this chart. And what I suggest is that if you want to end up somewhere up here, you actually need to be competent and capable in a third axis. And I call it the power skills. And in my concept of power skills, this competency is relating to your awareness, having a strategic awareness of what's going on in terms of the politics within your organization, but then using your power skills of communication, negotiation, influencing skills, managing up. They're all your power skills, and they're the things that are going to help you end up here. Because if you lack those skills, you might have a strategic awareness of what's going on within your organization, but you're still going to be spending your time lower down. And then you've got people who have very low strategic awareness and, you know, might be very good at their job, but they're basically over this side of the diagram. So that's what I talk to people about when I'm coaching and training. And I wanted to share that with you because it really helps you understand how I see this whole concept of understanding the shadow organization structure and how that fits in to you being a power assistant. What I'm going to talk you through today in terms of a way to think about the shadow organization structure is actually not something that I've invented. I've borrowed it and I'm sharing it with you. And it's a concept that I first heard about from a lady called Jo Miller. She is an executive leadership coach and trainer. She's actually Australian, but she's based in the US. Somewhere in the Midwest, and she has a firm company called Be Leaderly, and I'll put some links in my slides so you'll be able to go and check Jo out. But basically, Jo did a video on YouTube that I happened to see, and I absolutely loved the way she helps you navigate that shadow organization structure. So that's the concept that I'm going to be taking you through today. Now, what are we actually talking about when we talk about a shadow organization structure? If I still haven't quite got you to the point of understanding that, here's one more way of thinking about it. Think about it in terms of power and influence within an organization. You have what's called positional authority, which is where by virtue of the job title, somebody has natural, well, sometimes unnatural, but they have authority. It's called positional authority. And then you have what's called situational authority, which is where somebody may not have the job title that goes with a concept of having power and authority, but in actual fact, because of the situation, they're actually wielding quite a bit of situational authority. As executive assistants, you are often, if you're supporting somebody senior enough, you are often wielding what's called situational authority. So another way of thinking about this structure, shadow organization structure, is to actually think about how that factors in. That it's not just what is on paper in terms of somebody having a job title, and that should denote them having power and influence within an organization, because it sometimes it can actually be other people, like perhaps you, that is actually somebody that somebody else would actually be mapping as somebody that has real power and authority within an organization. So first thing I want to tell you as we get into this is that everything that I'm talking about today in terms of how the various steps work is going to be something that you can download later on. Anyway, there are 6 steps for you to think about, and I'm going to run through each one of them and then we'll wrap it up. So the first step is for you to choose those 5 people, because as I said, it's not realistic that you are going to do a shadow organization map for your entire organization. It's just not feasible. You might want to build on this initial shadow org map, but for the purposes of you getting familiar with the concepts that I'm talking about, let's start with 5 people. And because I wanted to be able to do this as an interactive exercise, hence I'm up and moving around, not sitting in my chair, I've drawn up my 5 people that I've chosen. So I've got John, I've got Kate, I've got Ben, I've got Mary, I've got Sharif, and I've got Mike. So, you know, think about your organization and think about, as I said, it would be good for you to start with the person that you're supporting and yourself, and then choose 3 other people that are around you in the organization. I do think that it makes sense to make those people somewhat related in terms of the 5 people. So you wouldn't go about choosing 5 people that are random all over the org chart. That's just going to be too hard for you to work with. So for the purposes of the exercise, make sure that they're 5 people that are around you. Now, step 1, as I said, is to choose your 5 people. Step 2 is to mark using, should have said in step 1, is you're going to need some color pens. And so for the purposes of step 1 or step 2, I'm going to do my relationships in red, and I'm going to do my solid relationships are going to be a solid red, and my fractured relationships or relationships that are under strain, where the relationship is not very productive, I'm going to do in blue. So for the purpose of this exercise, let's just draw some lines. So say, for example, let's take John and Kate. Now, as you can see on the org chart, they happen to be peers on the org chart. And I would, you know, say for the purposes of this exercise, they have a solid working relationship. However, as I said, I do have the option using a dotted or dashed line to indicate a relationship that is more strained. Now, why do you want to know that? Because you want to notice, you want to be curious about the sorts of relationships that are at play within an organization. So, you know, hypothetically, if you take, for example, our next level on my chart, let's say Mary and Sharif, they're meant to be team members. They're on the same level. They're meant to be operating, reporting into John. But for whatever reason, worthwhile you actually reflecting on what that might be at the root of it, we can actually say, or you can actually say, that they actually have a slightly, you know, tense relationship, or whatever you, however you want to describe it. But for the purposes of our diagram, we're going to mark them with a dotted or dashed line. So let's say we also have Mary and Mike. And Mike doesn't report to Mary, he reports to Ben, but he has to deal with Mary, and you have observed that they have a difficult working relationship, that there have been problems. So again, you would show that they have a dashed line connecting them. And again, you're going to mark in the other relationships. So for the purposes of this exercise, you're going to be, you know, I've drawn a few lines, but you're going to basically be drawing a line that connects each of these people. So Ben and Mary are connected. Ben and Sharif are connected. And, you know, so on and so forth. As you can see, the lines are totally up to you. If you feel that that is a relationship that needs to be reflected in your shadow org diagram, because it's important in terms of how things get done and how, you know, decisions are made in your organization, how business is transacted in your organization, how things are actually achieved and things move forward in your organization, then you want to reflect it using whether it's a dotted or a dashed line. Now, the next thing you're going to do with a different color is you're going to have a think about where the direction of how the relationship and influence flows, or how the influence flows in those relationships. So again, if I go to my diagram, and I'm going to use my green marker here, we've got a relationship between John and Kate. So as I said, on the face of it, they're peers. They're on the same level in the organization. But the reality is that informally, one or other of those people, whether it's John or whether it's Kate, could potentially be more influential, even though formally they are peers. Do you see what I mean? So for the purposes of this exercise, I'm going to actually say that the power and influence actually flows towards John. So in actual fact, what I'm saying is that John, although he's on the same level as Kate, she defers to him in terms of decision making and authority. Does that make sense? I love how I'm asking you these hypothetical questions. Feel free to email me after the session if you've got any questions. I'd love to be able to hear your feedback and answer anything that might come up. Anyway, so as you can see, the same thing applies in your other people that you've identified. So in the for the purposes of Ben and John, I'm going to say that that is, you know, as per the org chart and as per what you would expect, that John has the power and authority informally as well as formally in that relationship. And then in terms of Ben, Mary and Sharif and Mike, again, I would think about and reflect on where that power is flowing, how it's flowing, and I would reflect that using my arrows. But we're going to move on. The next thing we're going to do is we're actually going to use our purple marker, and we're going to mark what's called halos and horns. Now, I think they're pretty self-explanatory, but most people will be able to very quickly identify within their five people that they've chosen, who are people that they feel are positive, angels, people that could have a halo, and people that are best to be, you know, not avoided, I don't want to say avoided, but handled carefully, handled maybe with kid gloves, or given not assume that things are going to go smoothly with interactions with that person. So again, for the purposes of our exercise, I'm going to reflect that on my diagram by drawing my halos and horns. And I'm going to be honest here and say that, you know, again, it doesn't necessarily need to mean that in terms of, you know, what we think of as a command and control structure, where it's the boss at the top of the tree that can be the person with the horns. As you would all be able to attest to, that person can actually be somebody within the organization further down that's actually on the surface should not be able to wield so much power, should not be able to cause so much chaos. But if we're not aware of this person, we can get tripped over by them and caught up in their drama. So again, I think it's worth going through this exercise and saying, okay, these are people that I actually know, I feel are people that I can work well with, that I do work well with. And then there's other people, perhaps like Mary, where I need to be, you know, have my wits about me. Is we're going to draw what's called vertical sponsorship lines or lines of sponsorship. And again, this is a concept that I'm sure you see, but you may never have actually mapped it. And that is thinking about people who have a sponsorship arrangement where somebody is being supported by somebody more senior in the organization. So let's have a look here, and we'll say, for argument's sake, we're going to say that that is actually our friend Sharif and our friend John. And what I'm reflecting there is that they actually have a sponsorship arrangement where John is sponsoring Sharif, making sure that he has, that he's there as a sounding board, that he's somebody that Sharif can rely on to be given, you know, an accurate lay of the land in terms of things going on in the organization. Now, I've also realized that I have actually missed out on one thing, and that is what we call coalitions, which again are also a way of you reflecting what the power structure is within your organization. And for the purposes of this exercise, I'm going to say that we actually have a coalition between Ben, Sharif, and Mike. And you can see that what we've basically got is Mary here that is quite isolated. So in actual fact, just by looking at this with all of the things that I have reflected here, you're really spending time really assessing the informal structure that's going on and getting the time to actually reflect on what's going on. Who's in, who's out, who has support, who doesn't have support. All of those things might seem irrelevant, but they may actually be really relevant in terms of when you need to get things done and you need to get things signed off or approved or work completed or delegate something that your boss has asked to have something delegated within the organization to be completed. And your awareness of how all of these things function can be really, really valuable to you actually being effective and valuable to your business leader, to your boss. And at the end of the day, that's what I want for you. I want you to have that awareness through doing exercises like this, which might look like a dog's breakfast, but as I said to you, there's a handout. And just so you know, there is a podcast episode, which I will also include in the notes for today's presentation, because my podcast, Being Indispensable, is all about the skills, values, and behaviors of indispensable assistants. And something like this is really fundamental to you showing up as irreplaceable to your boss. So, in the interest of time, I'm going to finish it there. Not sure if you can hear my dog outside barking and wanting to be let in, but I think that's telling me that I need to wrap it up. So, bottom line is that I want you to stay alert, not alarmed, about the informal power dynamic operating within your organization, and be curious and interested in the relationships that are going on around you. I hope you've enjoyed today's presentation, and I hope you enjoy the rest of the virtual summit. Thanks for listening.